you have to admit. Welcome. My name is Barbara Schatting. I work at Student Generale as a program maker. And tonight is actually one of the first nights since the lockdown that we're opening with a lecture. And I'm really, 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 really proud that this is a lecture that we had planned originally for the spring. I think it was planned on March 23, so it's exactly 6 months ago. And by then, obviously, we had to cancel, but yes, we're open and we can not so much do a recit, but the actual lecture itself. We're going to talk about urban planning within the Anthropocene. This lecture was originally curated in collaboration with Global Europa, it still is, but it was part of the side programming of their project or exhibition, Landscape as Code. And therefore, I'm really proud to announce Floris Spandok. She's the director of Global Europa, and she will tell you a bit more about the exhibition and also about tonight's speaker. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Barbara. Thank you very much, University of Maastricht and Barbara, for our collaboration. And very much welcome to Floris Alkemade. In spring, Bureau Europa, Platform for Architecture and Design, showcased a number of projects handling landscape design and the Anthropocene. Featured projects, design practices, and artists that both analytically and critically examined contemporary society, using nature as a subject or sometimes as a metaphor. In the exhibition, and I'm sad that we could not share it today with you, we look back, coming from the 19th century, to today's practices. Today, we will focus on urban development in the Anthropocene. The Anthropocene is our time when human beings are highly influential or even in control of society and the design of our environment. Floris Alkemade, I sometimes call him a rock star in our architecture world of the Netherlands. He was appointed in 2015 as a chief government architect. And he has been handling many pragmatic issues, but also focusing on social implications and design, bringing together people to discuss it. I think that you are having a media moment in this week, because last week your documentary came out. We have a beautiful essay published, and also this week you have the panorama showcasing every day on the Dutch panorama. Floris will take us to the Anthropocene and your future, and I think it's very nice that coming from Bureau Europa, where we had looked a bit back and to the current status, that probably right now you will hear something good about the future. Welcome, Floris Alkemade. For you who don't know, Floris Alkemade was appointed in 2018 as Architecture of the Year. He has a long practice. He was for 7 years affiliated as partner at OMA and started his own agency in 2008, FAA, his own agency, and it's currently also in Paris based. Welcome very much, Floris Alkemade.
Yeah, thank you for the invitation, and I'm really happy that also in this COVID time we still have the possibility, if all the buttons are... Does it work better now? Yeah, I believe so. Huh? Okay. But thank you for the invitation, and I'm really happy to be here in Maastricht and to be able to give a lecture, a live lecture, as well as being online at the same time. I'll talk about urbanism, and to me urbanism never is about architecture and buildings alone. For me it's really a social profession, so that's why I usually call urbanism the art of living together, because in the end that's what the profession is about. I will try to lecture you on the evolution, maybe, but also on the different scales you can operate in. So I start on the big scale with the big abstract themes, and I work my way down to the small scales. We know what cities are. Somehow we all have in our mind, in our memory, the kind of ideal city. I usually have this image. This is Berlin, pre-war Berlin, as a kind of prototype of what we feel that a city should be like. Whether things are balanced, right, whether there's a public space, whether there's a public life, etc. But of course, cities have changed. If you look at what is happening worldwide now, it's a different kind of city that is emerging. So what's happening? What is happening with the art of living together? What is happening with the economics behind it? What is happening with the design? What are we longing for? And what is the real mechanisms that we can distinct behind what we produce? If I try to summarize the long history of urbanism, then I can summarize it in two images, maybe. We came from the left. This is a reconstruction of Piranesi, of ancient Rome. And on the right, you see Sun City, a kind of modern urbanism. Of course, these are the two extremes. But what it does show is that we come from an open urban structure, open public spaces, open buildings, and that we evolved to isolation and separation. If I summarize the history of world architecture in two images, these could be two images representing what happened to us. Total openness, total interaction towards separation and isolation. I'm not saying it's necessarily bad, I'm just saying this is happening. And we should be aware of it, of what the implications are. And that's why I gave my lecture subtitle Changes, evidently David Bowie's song. And these are all graphs showing what is changing in our world. And we, as a generation, we witness many, many changes. It's not very readable, but let me assure you that a lot of things in this world are going really, really well. If you look at how poverty in the world is decreasing, if you look at how schooling is increasing, the vaccinations of children, a lot of things are going very well in our world. Something we should be aware of, the fact that we are so wealthy, that we are so technically evolved, starts to have its impact on the world. Great achievement. If you look, for instance, at the world population. This is a report that really recently came out, and until now, the idea was that the world population would grow until the end of the century and reaching about 11 billion people. But now the new insights show that actually women are getting much less children than expected. And what you see is that the increasing of the wealth, increasing of schooling and the conception is having an effect. So now the predictions are on. This is based on the combination of many, many different scientific researches, is that the world population will start to decline as of 2064. Of course, these are predictions. No prediction is always correct, but it does mean something. The world population now is no longer growing because we have more children. The world population is growing because people are getting older. And that's a one generation thing. So in that sense, in 44 years from now, declination of the world population. This is an enormous important change. This will affect the way we deal with our planet. For our planet, it will be easier to take all these humans. It also will mean something for our societies, for the power structures, for our cities. Another change. One, we should take obsolete really serious, the declining biodiversity. This is something we cannot wait until 2064. This is something we have to address right now. This is one of the major changes where we are responsible. We should take action there. We can take action. It is not easy. And of course, climate change. The temperature rising through CO2 emissions. And this, of course, is the key questions to many, many elements we have to face. A big question, if humanity can solve this climate change, if we can deal with the way we emit CO2. Science tells us above 1.5 degrees temperature rise, the effects will become irreversible and unpredictable. And that is not a good combination. And if you look at how we are doing, it's so far not very effective, the policies we have on that point. So the aim is 1.5 degrees. It looks like 3 degrees is much more realistic as in something that will happen. And this means, obviously, again, a lot. This means sea level rise. And if you look at where the world population is living, it's amazing to see how many people live in coastal areas. And not only that, if you look where the cities are really growing, where they are expanding, it's in the majority in the coastal areas. So that's a vulnerability. Miami, Sea View. Miami is one of the most threatened cities on this planet, if you look at sea level rise. But if you're living in America, climate change is not a scientific thing to say, it's a political thing to say. It means that in the current politics, they do not take it as a scientific given, but it will happen, and it will happen sooner than we think. If you look at another sea view, the blue here is the sea. And these concrete walls look solid, they look massive, but they failed during the last tsunami. Big questions, how do we deal with all the changes that are overcoming us? Mechanization, again, a change where we can ask the question, who is controlling it? Gideon wrote this book directly after the Second World War saying, take care, mechanization takes command. We are no longer controlling it. What are the inhuman consequences of the way we make our machines? And of course, it's something we see and witness in our daily life, or better, most of the things mechanization does, we do not see. Like these machines, they operate for us. But there are not many people who like to see what's happening there. And of course, all these technical evolutions change our lives profoundly. When I started my career in 1990 at OMA, we had an office where everybody was still working on big drawing tables with ink pens, making drawings. And when I entered the office in 1990, two small Atari computers also entered the office. And we had some people working on these Ataris, trying to make a drawing, and they would work 1 week, and then you would have one drawing where we said, well, we can make this drawing in half an hour. So we were convinced computer drawings, that is not the future. 5 years later, the last drawing table left the office. So it's a tradition of millennia architects making drawings. And it took only 5 years to change and to end that culture. And that is, of course, one example of many, many examples that we are all experiencing. Things are changing. Not because, as a collective, we ask for it, because it happens, because it's possible. And that's fascinating, and it's hard to grasp what is happening, what is really taking control. This is a graph showing the money trade. This is where the value of our money is determined. And these are not people trading. These are automated algorithms fighting each other. And this is milliseconds where they take decisions, where they buy, where they sell. This is controlling our life. And there's hardly anybody on this planet who still knows what are these algorithms exactly doing there. And how stable is the system? It's happening, it's determining our life, but who controls? Another change related to that is screen time. This is a graph showing how many minutes a day we look at a screen. These are different nations, and I added to the screen, I added the 1,000 minutes, because a day we are more or less 1,000 minutes awake every day. Out of these 1,000 minutes, now on average, this is pre-corona graph, people are looking almost half of their time that they are awake at a screen. An average American adult looks 640 minutes a day at a screen, whether it's computer, TV, or your iPhone. It means something. It means that the real world and real time is losing its importance. Screen time is getting more and more part of what our lives are about. And that has a lot of good things. It's amazing what these new technologies bring us. It's amazing how well we are connected. It's amazing that people I cannot see now still can see this lecture. Huh? Great. But what does it mean that we somehow are so addicted, so in need of all these screens? It does mean something. Huh? And our iPhone, it's only 11 years old. Huh? Let's see what it changed. These are all people, students, looking and researching Rembrandt, of course, but nevertheless. Because in the end, all this screen time has its effect on the real world, in real time. We see these big boxes being built in our landscapes, where we store all the things we used to buy in our shops. And all of a sudden, what we buy is determined by Chinese people, or something. It's a kind of global thing. And at the same time, we see in our city centers that our shops are getting empty. So it has a direct effect on who we are, who we live, and what we do. And also devotion has a new meaning. And it's fascinating to witness, to see these changes, but also fascinating to ask yourself, okay, but what does it mean for me? Do I have a free choice? Where is my freedom? Is it something we should embrace, or is it something we should reject? Is it something we can control? All kinds of questions that have to do with the way we live together. It has to do with how we as a society operate. And our society, of course, is changing. Currently, we are growing in the Netherlands towards about 40% of all the households being one-person households. A rapid change. One generation ago, we lived in families. In popular cities nowadays, it's about half the households that are one-person households. Big change for our society. And it, you see it everywhere. Huh? This sense of, okay, but what are we still having in common? What is the interaction? What does urban city life mean? It's a culture question, it's a technology question, it's an urban question, it's an architectural question. It touches everything. Again, I'm not saying this is per definition wrong, but it is changing our lives, it's affecting our lives, and we should always be aware of how do you control your own life and your own things. And what does it lead to? Houellebecq, the French writer, he has a very dystopian view of our society. And he says, well, the increasing entropy is a kind of nature, a law of nature. The universe has the law of increasing entropy. And he says the same law is also the law that affects our society, the way we live together. And in the end, he says, there is no society. We all will be atomized individuals. Dystopian view, and but a great writer. Huh? So read his books, because it's a kind of brutal explanation of what we might face. But always important to read more than one writer. Saul Bellow, he says, I think, a very interesting thing about already more than half a century ago. And he says, it's never easy to live in your own time and age. And it's never easy to be strong enough to see all these things, changes.
Ben je gerustgesteld, Paul?
Ik ga het nu voor dat eigenlijk straks op dit.
Kunnen we er niet
doen? Dan doen we dat even.
Ja.
Dan gaan we nu verder als het goed is.
Ja, en ik heb mooi de gelegenheid gehad om een glas water te pakken, waardoor ik zeker niet ga hoesten zo meteen. Maar terechte opmerking, absoluut. Saul Bellow. I think what he says is a very fundamental thing. And what you also recognize is that for nobody, no matter what time you are born, whether it's in a different century or different epoch, everybody always finds it difficult to live in its own time, because things, the future is unpredictable. You always see the threat. And he said, he acknowledges that. And he said, no problem with that, but don't long for a better past, because there is no way back. We're going forward. We have to learn to long for the future. That is what every generation is facing. And that's something I think leads, hopefully, to a more optimistic view, not the dystopian view of Ulbeck. I think that's also, if we talk about planning, if we talk about architecture, if we talk about society, if we talk about urbanism, it has to have this trace of optimism. It has to have this element of believing in a better future. No matter how difficult the questions are, no matter whether the sea level is rising, no matter whether it's declining biodiversity, you have to believe that we can do better, and you have to take responsibility. And that's what urbanism is about. And it's also what science tells us. Science tells us we need change. The way we are living now, the way we are producing our food, the way we are building our cities, it's leaving a trace of destruction. We need to change fundamentally. And if you read this carefully, then this is a definition of a revolution. And that's fascinating, because usually it's the people who ask for a revolution, and now it's science asking for a revolution. And of course, all these changes, it's not easy to define the directions. What do you need to take into account? And that's something I try in different ways to address. It's also something we try to address with het College van Rijksadviseurs, the government advisors. I also wrote this essay about the future of the Netherlands. And basically, my angle is the way we live, we destroy so much. We destroy what is beautiful, we destroy what is not replaceable, and that is not acceptable. We destroy beauty. So let's find ways to change things. And then the question is, of course, who will direct us? This is the selection of world leaders we currently have in power. Well, who do we trust in? You can have your own pick there, but I have the feeling it won't come from these gentlemen. I don't think they are busy with an agenda that really changes profoundly the way this world is producing, etc. Maybe the best bet will be China. Xi might be the person who has the most potential on that point. But I think there is another nation on Earth that has a big potential on that, and that is the Netherlands. And that sounds like totally out of the question. Huh? We are so small. Our population is so little if you compare it to the world population. But I think there's another thing at stake, namely that the Netherlands, being in a totally impossible position in this world, fighting against the water all the time, has a unique combination of qualities. First of all, we have a long, long history of collaboration, fighting against the sea. It does mean something. We are extremely wealthy. We are well educated. We are well organized. You could also reverse the question. If our nation can deal with these big questions, the sea level rise, the biodiversity, etc., the energy transition, if our nation cannot deal with it, nobody can. We are the best positioned with all our qualities. So that is, I think, the responsibility we have to take. It's not that we are big. It's not that if we meet all the objectives, the world will be saved. But I think we can develop the knowledge. We can develop the principles. So this is a world map I drew for the essay, where every pixel represents 17 million people. So that is the population of the Netherlands. So we are the blue square on the right. And then the world population is all the other pixels. So we are small. And there are 453 other pixels of 17 million people. But look at it, how well we are positioned to develop the right knowledge. At this moment already, 90% of all disasters in the world are water related. Whether it's too much water, not enough water, polluted water. This is where we excel. So let's take our responsibility and look what we can do. So for us as chief government architect and as the collegium of advisors of the government, we said let's try to make a vision of what the Netherlands should look like in 2050. 30 years from now, that's about the time frame we have to deal with all these big questions. And 2050 looks like far away, but in time, it's as far away from us as is 1990, 30 years in the other direction. It's not so many years. And the questions, of course, we face are serious. We say, let's deal with these questions looking from a spatial point of view. And that's interesting. All these big questions that we are now facing as a generation are spatial questions. So design questions, social questions. We also said look integral. So it's not that we can look at food production without looking at climate change. It's not that we can look at urban, where do we build houses, without looking at how we deal with water questions or with food productions. So we say we combine them. And long term. Because of course, politics often are linked to the rhythm of elections. So they have to deal within 4 years between promise and delivering. And these questions you cannot deal with in 4 years. The same with the markets. They have a return on investment, which usually is 2 years, 3 years. These questions ask long-term vision. So we did that. And I'm not going to explain the entire panorama. There's a beautiful website showing it. What we're showing is a horizon of the Netherlands, full circle, where we explain, okay, what will the Netherlands look like if we deal with all these questions, if we deal with them rightly, and what are then the principles we have to obey to implement in order to make that happen. And a very optimistic view. In the end, it's not an easy task, but it's far from being impossible. And this, of course, is a panorama, a horizon. But behind it are a lot of scientific reports, or a lot of investigations, or a lot of studies. But we thought it's very important to have a tool to communicate how it works together. What happens if you look at it in a way that all these questions are connected. And a beautiful panorama which we made, and where we traveled around in the Netherlands, and we thought that would last for 1 year, but I think the panorama is already almost 2 years old now, and we still have demands. We have a second panorama printed, and wherever we go, we have lectures, we have debates. It is a beautiful tool to make people aware of the fact that it's possible, that you can take responsibility, and that it has a way of improving life. There's a lot of quality we can gain with the big questions that we are facing now. And I think that optimism it's not easy, because there's a lot of reasons to be pessimistic. It is not going well in the world. On the other hand, we see the beginning of an awareness. We see a beginning of a lot of people taking responsibility. And I always say this is the most beautiful spot on the graph you can have. Huh? This is where you feel the force. Huh? The turning of a direction is never easy, but this is where it becomes relevant what choices we make, what beliefs we have. And as I said, behind the panorama, we make a lot of studies. Huh? We made Via Paris, where we investigated, okay, what will the Netherlands look like if we aim for 100% renewable energy? What choices do we have to make? What will the underground look like? What will be above ground? What will be the effect on the landscape? A lot of questions we have to face as a generation, and again, showing that it's far from impossible. But you need to design it, you need to discuss it, you need to develop the technologies for it. And that's the good thing about, I think, Europe, that there is a real agenda now, and things are being also regulated, there are objectives, there is things happening. And that's a beautiful moment to live in. For the first time, mankind is trying to change its direction and not leaving a trace of destruction. And as I said, all these questions are spatial questions. They have to do with the way we live. They have to do with the way our country works. This is 3 times 100 by 125 kilometers. And as you can see, these three urban conditions have more or less the same number of inhabitants. Of course, the Netherlands is a bit smaller in number, but more or less the same. And it's fascinating to see how different the Netherlands are. We have not this centralistic big metropolitan area like Paris and London. We have a scattered urban pattern. It's not very readable, I think, but of course, beautiful. Amsterdam, and we have Eindhoven here to give you some idea of where we're looking at. And of course, this means something for public transport, it means something for the urban tissue, it means something for the quality of life. I think this is a very nice condition to live in, and also urbanistically important to realize what the relation with the countryside is. So the Netherlands, of course, is producing a lot of food. And if you look at this is a percentage of our income that we spend on food. So you see that in 1969, people were still spending about 1/4 of their income on food. Our generation, it's now about 10-11% of our income. Maybe for students it's different, that I do not know, but it means something. This is what progress looks like. This is what the technical innovation in our countryside looks like. This is also what declining soil conditions, declining biodiversity looks like. We lost the habit to pay for the real value of our food. It means that we forced our farmers to produce as much as possible for as little money as possible. And the choices we make as civilians, we see in nature, we see in the way our farmers have to produce their food. I think that's something we also should look at. You cannot talk about urbanism if you do not talk about the countryside, if you do not talk about the way we serve our cities with energy, we serve our cities with food which is produced elsewhere. We even serve our cities with youngsters who live who are raised in different places, but all go to these cities. Cities are artificial entities, and they are being fed. And we have to look into what does that mean for the countryside, because it's part of the way our cities function. And what I always find fascinating is that we always have the image of the city, of the source of all modernity, of all radical lifestyles. But if you look at what is happening at the countryside, if you want to see real modernization, real radical changes, then I think on the countryside you see them more and more explicit than in our cities, something we have to be aware of. It means also something for where the money is generated. This is maybe a bit difficult to explain. This is Barnard Newman's painting. I repainted it, now it's becoming a graph. What it basically shows is that the Randstad, our four big cities in the west side of the country, the Randstad plus the surrounding areas, and there live about one third of the people, and they generate about one third of the national income. So the idea that outside the Randstad there's less economic force is out of the question. Outside the Randstad we generate two thirds of the national income. And then if you look at the yellow, that is what food production, the landbouw is producing, agriculture is producing. So it's not so that outside the Randstad there's only farmers generating money. There's a lot of other things happening. Something which still is hard to grasp for the people living in the Randstad, because they have the feeling, well, we are generating the economics, we are generating the money. It's not true. And that's something we have to learn when we look at the Netherlands and we look at the way countryside and city life are working together. It's all part of a system that works together. And that's something which also means we have to take responsibility for it. Interesting questions and a fascinating evolution in the way we appreciate also the countryside. For us as advisors for the government, we say, well, look how rich the culture of identities in the Netherlands are. Look at how beautiful this pattern of different regions is, and they share a history, they share an identity, they share also like how many houses they have to build. It's different from region to region. So let's not try to annihilate these differences, but actually to extrapolate the differences between the regions. Make them different as possible based on the history they were working with. And that, I think, is what these big questions can generate, a richer, diverse country. Because if we talk about biodiversity, it's not only animal and plant life. I think it's also to do with identities. It also has to do with something in the real world that counter the technology revolutions that try to make us more and more the same. Amidst all these changes I've shown you, I think there's always the question of morality. I think there's always a question, okay, but what choices do we take and how can we know whether we do the right thing? And as I said in the beginning, I call urbanism the art of living together, and I think that's what it's about. Like, what morality do we have behind all our decisions? Because spatial planning never is an aim. Spatial planning is the means to have a good society. And this good society, I'll always love this quote of Simone de Beauvoir, who says, if you want to look at what the real value of a society is, look then how they take care of the most vulnerable in that society. I think that's true in her age as it is in our age, as it is in all ages. I'm convinced that if we deal well with the most vulnerable, we deal well with everybody. And that, of course, is also something we are facing in the Netherlands, but also worldwide. An aging population, what does it mean? Different households, what does it mean for a city like Maastricht? Does it mean we no longer build houses for the youngest? Is it only building houses for the old people? I don't think so, but we have to be aware of how our society is changing in that respect. And there, I think, the first lesson when you talk about social issues is a lesson, what do we not see? And in my essay, I start with this astronomer who lived in the beginning of the last century, and he was convinced that he had discovered on the Venus and on Mars canals. And he said, well, there must be a real society there. There must be intelligent life forms because they make canals. So he made of the planets all kind of maps, tracing the canals he saw in his telescope. And of course, there is no canals there, but they found out that his telescope had a flaw, that it reflected his own eyeball. So what he was drawing was his own eyeball. And I use that as a metaphor of how we all look at the world. We look at the world, but we first of all see ourselves. And that's a kind of blindness we have to be aware of, especially if you talk about social issues. In the Netherlands, the two people on the left, on average, have a life expectancy which is 6-7 years shorter than the two people on the right. If we try to make our way of living more sustainable, one way or another, the poor families who are less responsible for all the pollution, for all the CO2, are paying the highest prices. How is that possible? Something, somehow, we are not aware of, how our implementation of all these new regulations are implementing the lives of the people who cannot bear it and who are not responsible for it. Solidarity of a theme, as a theme. You probably recognize the photo on the right side, huh? How we reacted on the influx of refugees, 2015. And of course, we all feel offended by these people. Say, oh, how is it possible that they are reacting in this way? And again, I think it's a matter of being blind, because these people, of course, I despise the way they act and they react. But look at this. Where do all the asylum centers arrive in the end? And you see the Randstad, the cities in the west, not showing up in this map. It means that in the Randstad, it were not the people doing this, but it were the lawyers, it were the politics, people who were well organized to block the influx of the refugees. So in the end, all the asylum centers ended up in the other side of the country. So you can say, well, we are offended by the people here on the right, but the people who really block them are people with a nice suit and tie. So what is the morality behind that? We, of course, are very offended by Trump. Huh? It's the favorite topic in every conversation these days. And the wall he builds between Mexico and US, if it's a wall at all, how is it possible that the president does these kind of things? What kind of politics is he following? But then look at the walls we built, and not at our borders, but in the middle of our cities. These are walls. These are walls to exclude people. If you look at the city of Rotterdam, a beautiful new station, a very welcome gesture. This is our station. But you have to realize that in the city of Amsterdam, 1 in 4 children is growing up in poverty, and they won't be able to pay any ticket to ride. So you're building that station, but then you make a wall kicking out these children. In Rotterdam, there's a lot of poverty, a lot of old people are living in poverty. So you make a lot of gestures, but in the end, we also build walls. I think it's true with all these questions where we feel so offended by people we see doing things where we say, well, you should not do it. But I think it's first of all looking, okay, but what are the consequences of what we do and what we find normal? And that's what Bertolt Brecht also said already more than almost a century ago. The people in the dark, we don't see them. And he meant actually the same. You should look better of the consequences of what we are doing. And that sense, I think solidarity is the guiding theme of everything we do, plan, and the decisions we take. Very important as a theme. But how can we take responsibility? This is Pussy Riot, people who try and who dare to stand up against Putin, and that is, I can guarantee you, asking for a lot of courage, more courage than we can deliver. And I don't think it's a matter of courage. I think it's a matter of, at least where we can take our responsibility, is of can we imagine change? Also, in my essay, I use this example of this Hadza warriors. These are the last hunter-gatherers who are still living in their original lifestyle. People who survive in an area where we would not survive for one day. And they have a lot of knowledge of hunting and finding food. And in a scientific experiment, these people were displaced. So they put them in an area, you see it here, where they had never been before. And the scientific question was, okay, but what do they do to find food? Is it that they will walk a straight line? Is it so that they will walk in circles? What will be their strategy? So they had the GPS watch, so they could track their movements. And on the right, you see the movement they make. And it looks totally chaotic, but it is not. It's a very specific pattern. It's a pattern you can describe in a mathematical way. And it's called the survival pattern. And it's a very fascinating pattern. It's a pattern that you also see with whales in the ocean. You see it in bees who are trying to find food. You see it in a lot of bird species. You see it, it's a pattern that nowadays is also found in the newest search engines on internet. And the essence of this pattern is the possibility, the capability to change direction. We all are trained to walk from A to B, and that is the line to go. And that's a very smart strategy if you know where B is. If you do not know where B is, if you do not know where you will find your food, then following a straight line is lethal. And the essence of this pattern is the capability of change direction. So what these people are doing, they're walking a direction, analyzing, very well observing, change direction. I think this is where we as a generation stand for. We have so many big questions confronting us. There are so many unknown answers. That following a straight line, no matter what direction, will be lethal. Our generation will be trained, will be have to train in changing direction. And that's also what science asks us. And that is what life will make much more interesting. I think this is fun, this is adventurous, and this is what culture should be about. COVID. We witness it, and we witness is a lot of changes all of a sudden overcoming our lives. We change because we have to. But we change out of fear. We know, okay, but we might be contaminated, etc., etc., and all of a sudden we change our lives. And I don't think we need changes out of fear. I think we need changes out of a longing. What do we want? It should not be a virus telling us how to change our lives. Of course, we can learn a lot of this crisis, but I think if we wait until we are as afraid of the virus, as afraid of climate change and biodiversity declining, if we wait that long that we are really afraid, then we'll be too late. We have to act earlier. But people don't like to change. I found this last week, it's amazing. People in COVID time miss flying. So what they now do, they offer flights to nowhere. So you land where you start from. And it's sold out, because people, I can fly again. And weird, people don't like to change. And it's something you see everywhere. people are trained to build cities to generate money. If you look at the city of Dubai, vacancy percent 43. Cities are no longer being built to live in. This is to make money out of habits. The systems are based on producing buildings, making money. Same in China. The Chinese people are getting richer, but they don't trust Chinese banks. So Chinese people who have money invest in houses. But they're making so much money that they invest in so many houses that these houses are no longer needed. So they have entire ghost cities. And it's not small. Currently, it's about 64 million empty homes. So we're talking a lot about making our buildings sustainable. And at the same time, on the other side of the planet, they are doing this. I once calculated that the empty houses in China are enough to house the entire population of France, Germany, and the Netherlands. So if the sea really overwhelms us, we always still can go to China to find our future. But it's amazing, all this production, simply because people do not change, no matter what. And that's something we have to face. And it has to do with identity. It has to do with believing in creating new identities. I want to show you one tale of, it's a fairy tale in the Netherlands, Almere. I once did this project, a city center project, and when I won the competition, the elder man asked me a very interesting question. And he said, if you build your plan, if you build your scheme, will this be the background of people who take a photo when they are being married? Interesting question. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, if people are getting married in Almere, they always go to Naarden or something, and then they have a castle on the background of their marrying picture. And I said, I want something in my city that people don't go elsewhere if they are getting married. And is your plan providing the background for pictures for people that are getting married? I said, well, I can promise you a lot, but not this. I said, I knew that, but he had an idea. He said, I want to build a castle in Almere. So then I have the background for these pictures. First of all, he wanted to buy a castle in the Czech Republic, then demolish it and rebuild it in Almere. But he soon found out that was far too expensive. So the next step was, he came to me and said, well, I found a beautiful castle in Wallonia, in Belgium. And I said, you're not buying a castle in Wallonia. He said, no, I'm not buying it. I'm just making a copy of it. So he had an entire plan to, and it happened. There was a big project started, all about creating an identity for the city. Fake identity, of course. But then, as history goes, it's always unexpected. During construction, more or less at this phase, they found out that the finance was not correctly calculated. So apparently somebody at the bank had signed an agreement that he could not have signed, so the project was stopped. And ever since, there's a ruin of a castle. And that's, of course, a beautiful tale, that instead of a fake castle, they have a genuine ruin. It's a beautiful outcome of a process of a search for identity. And it's romanticism. It's what can you long for? And I'm showing it because when people talk about identity in our modern world, they often have the feeling that you have to copy things. There are many Las Vegas, etc., in China, where they copy palaces from Venice, etc. And the idea is if we copy the form, then we copy the identity. And of course, that is not what our world is about. We have not to long for copies. We can do the real thing. And that, of course, has to do with how can we observe the world where we live in? What can we learn from the history of our own place where we live? And in the Netherlands, that of course has to do with water. This is a map from around 1600. Interesting thing of the old maps is that they're all river maps. And it shows shows how important river water has always been related to the places where we live. And that is something which is fascinating to see. In the village I lived, there was a person, Harry van Kuyk, who did a very precise investigation of old structures, water structures, superimposing them on the current tissue. And all of a sudden, you start to see a different village which you knew so long. All of a sudden, you start to realize, hey, there is a logic in there. And that logic you can implement in many different ways. I also did a study for Brabant where we took the water question as the main driver for change. Can we find a logic from landscape, from water? And that has to do with history, that has to do with identity. It's not fake, it's not a copy, it's the real world. And the good thing is that with all the climate change, it's the old historical layer that bears a kind of intelligence of a landscape that we can implement now. So we try to communicate that as a process. For the last 4 years, I've been teaching at the Academy of Architecture in Amsterdam, and my lectureship was called the Tabula Scripta. It's the opposite of the tabula rasa. I said, if we look at architecture, if we look at the way we build our cities, we should stop erasing our past. We are about to publish a book. It will be published in November, Rewriting Architecture. And the basis is, we are so trained to demolish and to start all over. But there is a much more intelligent and a much more interesting way of having architecture, dealing with rewriting it, taking what's there and giving it a different future. Something I've been doing for many times. A project still at OMA for Genoa in Italy. Beautiful, beautiful city. Old historical industrial building, a silo. The city had a competition saying, well, we want this building to be demolished. It's an industrial building which we do not like. And can you find something which will attract people? Our point of view was, but this building is beautiful. But the city convinced us, no, this is an ugly building. And so you have to demolish it. And we in a way, thought, well, can't we find a way out of it? So we started to talk to a lot of people living in Genoa. We asked them, okay, what does the city need? But we found soon out that the city had everything they wanted. They have the most beautiful museums in the world. They have all the cinemas they can ask for, the best food in the world. The quality of life in Genoa is explicit. So we asked a lot of people, what does Genoa need? And basically the question is, we don't need anything. So Rem said, okay, we have the answer. They don't need anything. Good luck. And so I had to find a trick to get out of there. So basically what I said, okay, if they don't need anything, let's give them nothing. And how do you design nothing? So we designed a hole in the sea. We said, well, this is nothing. This we cut out in the sea. Water and rectangle, and there on the bottom of the sea you will find Atlantis, the lost city, and we kept the tower of the silo. Now for us it was more an elegant way to escape from the competition, but somehow the Italians said, ah, great idea, please show us how you can do that. So we were entering the second phase of the competition, developing it as a cruise terminal, a kind of beautiful project, keeping the tower, etc., etc. In the end, we didn't win the competition. But somehow there started the fascination for rewriting architecture, not demolishing, but keeping it. Competition and a project I also did was the Zecher Zollverein, in the same respect. This is in Essen, Germany, Ruhrgebiet, old industrial buildings. Created by Schupp and Kremmer, who were two architects, students of Mies van der Rohe, so beautiful, strong steel brick architecture. No longer in use. The mines closed in 1985. And then the buildings had to be demolished. And they started to demolish a lot of buildings in the Ruhrgebiet, but then the people started to react and said, well, if we demolish all these buildings, where is our identity? Well, because the Ruhrgebiet, its identity is its industrial past. So we were asked to study the possibilities of the area. What can we do with it? And the process was such that we in the end made a plan that convinced UNESCO to make it a World Heritage Project. So from demolishing to making it a World Heritage Project took about only 15 years. We worked on the scheme, I think, 1 year in order to convince. But you see how rapidly it can change. The people are convinced buildings should be demolished. And then they look at it with a different eye, and then it becomes a World Heritage Project. And that's something you should be aware of. Because we made a lot of changes between consumption, from production to consumption, buildings, our heritage from these industrial times. They're so beautiful. They represent the world. And can we, instead of erase that, reuse it? So we made an entire scheme. Beautiful to see how nature took over the most contaminated part of our world. And an old building trying to make a machine building into a museum and a visitor center. I'm seeing I'm running out of time, so I'll go fast, but it's so fun to do and to make things possible, not by demolishing a building, but by adding a layer. Not to hide the face of your own generation, but to add something in which both times become more important. And so the same building that should have been demolished became the emblem when Esse became a cultural capital of Europe. So it's something you can do with rethinking, rewriting architecture. Another project I just recently accomplished in Paris. I have an office there as well, an old building, Entrepot building, 1968, 600 meter long building. They wanted to demolish it, but they found out that before this building there was a gas factory on this site, and so the soil was polluted. If they had to demolish the building, they had to clean the soil, which was too expensive. So our client, who organized the competition, said, I don't want to demolish the building, it's too expensive. Please give us other ideas. So we came up with a scheme which we won the competition. And I'm showing it to you because a building everybody thought was too ugly to maintain. By rewriting it, by reworking it, it now is being protected. Again, a project which shows you that you should not too fast decide to demolish buildings. If they are ugly, or are they not in use, or are they difficult to deal with. Tilburg. This is a shed close to the central station where they used to repair the locomotives of the Dutch railways. Closed down some years ago. The building had to be demolished because the city wanted to build houses on this spot. So the schemes were ready for the housings and then the crisis came, the economic crisis, and then the houses no longer could be financed. So they had the building and no longer a program. And then different people started to collaborate. They said, well, there must be much more possible in this building. And in the end, it's now one of the cultural hotspots of Tilburg. Again, a building they asked to be demolished. And all of a sudden, by rethinking it, by rewriting it, it became a very important building. And it has to do with urbanism, because this is what all of a sudden gave the entire city of Tilburg an enormous boost. And it's beautiful to see how you can deal with old industrial heritage, with an older generation, with an older meaning, and all of a sudden the building means something. Beautiful to see what it does. Rotterdam, in the harbor, Katoenveen. This is a building which will become a museum. Romendaad, one of the funding parties in the city of Rotterdam, wants to work with this building. Again, such a building. But everybody said, well, this building you never can rescue, too difficult, too cost, you never can finance it. But you can. And that is, I think, something we should learn, and that is true in our cities as it's in our landscapes, that by not erasing, we can add layers to our cities. That is also what biodiversity is about. I'm currently visiting ENSI factories, beautiful industrial heritage, trying to see if we can come up with an action where collaborating with the city, with the province, with the ENSI people to not demolish these buildings. Can we find a different future? They're beautiful. The position is beautiful, and it's amazing to see how rich its possibilities and its architecture are. Today I came a bit early to Maastricht in order to be able to visit the building Landbouwbelang. And I have the same feeling. If you look at it, it's not an easy building. It's not a well-maintained building. But it's a building that means a lot. This is a building that has an entire subculture, which is not an easy culture for a city to deal with, but it's the essence of what a city is about. That it houses different groups, different convictions, different age groups. And I'm convinced that this is a building which has so much beauty in it, that it again, like the Lokhal in Tilburg, can generate an enormous boost for the city of Maastricht. You really, as a city, should avoid raising this building. It has an identity, it has a possibility, it has a strength, it has a sincerity that you will hard to find with a new building. And this is what identities is about. This is what going to the river means. Look at it, the beauty. Deal with it and find a new future for it. And that does not mean that you cannot add houses, it does not mean that you not can change, it does not mean that you not can show your own generation. It's just about rewriting, it's about not erasing. That's what sustainability is about, that is what urbanism is about, that is what about living, the art of living together is about. But do realize the value you have in this building, and which is about to be very vulnerable at the moment. I want to end with, I think, four slides that summarize what I think is the message of this lecture. First, this one. This is a Japanese technique of repairing broken pottery. And the essence of this repair technique is that you repair it with gold. So they say there's beauty in things that are broken. I think this is how we should look at our city. This is how we should look at these big questions like climate change. It's clear that principles do not work anymore. We have to repair them, we have to change. But why not see the beauty in that what we have to change, see the quality of it and repair with gold? Second of the four is the labyrinth. Like I said, we do not know where B is. We do not know where to go. That sounds frightening because if we start something, we want to know where we will end. But I think it's like I showed with the Hadza hunter-gatherers. There's a beauty in changing direction. There's a beauty in not knowing where to go. There's a beauty in very clear observing the situation and then define a new direction and enjoy it. Enjoy the labyrinth. For the coming Dutch Design Week, we are making a big labyrinth in one of the old industrial buildings. Like, visit Strijp S in Eindhoven, visit the old industrial buildings in Eindhoven and see what a boost they gave to that city as well. Power of imagination. This is Constant Nieuwenhuis, who worked for, I think, 2 decades on one project, the New Babylon. Power of imagination, not to be disappointed in his own time, but find new ways. If the questions change, the answers have to change. And that was what Constant Nieuwenhuis is about. And my last slide, which I usually use to end my lectures, is the responsibility we have. You as a younger generation, I'm of an older generation, but I think one of the quotes I always like to use is that of Yeats, "In dreams begins responsibility." The fact that we can imagine that things will be better, that already creates a responsibility to go for it. And that's a beautiful responsibility. And the slogan of Paris, May 68, "Sous les pavés la plage," under the pavement waits the beach, I think is the best slogan ever. Huh? That is what imagination does. It changes pavement into the beach. And I think in that sense, all these big questions that are facing our generation, don't be afraid of it. The power of imagination, the power of collaboration will change it in something beautiful. Thank you.
I really do hope that among the 130 visitors at the live stream, there are some people that work at our municipality, because I'm really, really looking forward to the new opportunities for the NC and Landbouwbelang. I really do hope that they have some inspiration and that they will give you a call, because Zekers Overijn is amazing. But I would like to start with the rounds of questions we have among approximately 15 minutes. And I would like to have the honor to be the first, because actually I do have a question. In another essay you wrote, it's published in a Dutch collection of essays, it's called Leven in het Anthropocene. Your essay is called Urban Planning in the Anthropocene. You state that within the Anthropocene, the majority of the inhabitants of the world will live in cities. Like you said in the presentation before, and these cities are usually close to the sea. But these cities are also like on a really large scale. You showed some examples, 10, 15, 20 million people. That's not unique, that's quite common. What would you say is the best scale for an urban area or a city when it comes to the Anthropocene?
Well, obviously, bigger scale is more efficient.
Okay.
It's easier to
organize transport more efficiently, to be sustainable. In that sense, the bigger the scale, the better, you could say.
Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, I think it's very cultural related. If I travel in China and I see these big cities, to me, it's I could not live there. And if I'm in Manhattan, I worked a lot in Manhattan, I can live there. It's also the art, the history of a city, the way you organize these structures. But things change. And in that sense, it's interesting to see how the countryside now, as we are getting new attention. It's also interesting to see how we live in the Netherlands in a very low density, but with a very high quality of life. And maybe that's the future of all cities. Cities like Manhattan, its density is decreasing decade after decade after decade. And so in the end, more wealth probably also means more declining densities, which for our nature is not a very welcome message. But it's also, again, something we have to deal with. If people make these decisions, we have to find a way to work with it. And that's one of the things, maybe also an outcome of COVID, like in America, but also like in Belgium, you see people out of the COVID fear escaping the cities. All of a sudden, houses in the countryside are getting much more important. To have a garden has gained importance. And of course, if COVID has a vaccine in 1 year from now, then it might be reversed also next year. If this is lasting for more years, then it might be a profound change in the way we live. Because one of the interesting things that we learned also with COVID is that maybe the real revolution in transport is not that our cars will drive themselves or that they become electric. The real revolution in transport and transportation is that we find out that we might be able to live with less traveling. And that is a big important difference, huh? That we all of a sudden say, okay, but combining living and working could be interesting, huh? Or having workspaces closer from home so that we don't have to travel long distances. So a lot of things that's interesting of this time and period in the COVID are changing, and all what looked like self-evident all of a sudden is no longer self-evident, and that is interesting to witness.
Well, I'm great that you mentioned this, because this is what my next question would be then. Because in times of COVID, when I would talk to friends who actually live in the west of the Netherlands, like in Amsterdam, they were all pointing out that they expected me to have a more comfortable life because I was living in a small town. I had much of nature around me. I could cycle anywhere. I wasn't bound to making use of the public transportation. And also when I talk to, for instance, artists who work at the Van Eyck Academy, they usually mention that they like the scale of Maastricht because they think this is still like the scale for the city within the Anthropocene. But that maybe that next question, can we consider this a city or should this be like the countryside that is also in your talk?
Yeah, that's true. Before you say what size a city should have, you should define city, huh? Because city is something different. Huh? Like I showed this 100, 125 kilometer scale of the midsection of the Netherlands. You also can read that as one city. Huh? And what for you is the ideal size of a city, like maybe Maastricht, maybe for a Chinese is horrible. Huh? I say, oh, but it's so small and I can't find this and this. Huh? And it's very cultural related. And in that sense, there is no single answer to that question, which makes city life also more interesting. And it's also, of course, where you grow up. Huh? And that's interesting to see that no matter where people grow up, they always love the place where they grow up. Huh? In that sense, we're getting used to things. Huh?
But then we also start exploring the countryside, like Ram Koolhaas is now, like there is a big exhibition in Guggenheim about the countryside made by Ram Koolhaas, one of your former partners. Is that also a path we can take now when we start talking about the Anthropocene?
No, I think what Rem is fascinated is about the way the countryside is evolving now that most people are moving towards the city. So what is left behind and what is the industrial scale and the technology that is evolving there? Fascinating, but I also think there's more happening. Like how can we find a more sustainable way of producing our food? Is that meaning that we are totally industrializing food production? Or is it that we find food production in a way that it can be combined with nature? And that is a different technique, but also very interesting. And also the question, of course, is can we find a lifestyle where we not necessarily have to say, well, whatever is in the interest of the city is not in the interest of the countryside and vice versa? Can we mix them? And I think there's a world to win there.
Consider the Midlands of the Netherlands as a city, then there is a large countryside that we can mix with city life.
But if you look at all these investigations where we find that the people in the Netherlands are very, very happy, I think it has also to do with the quality of life that this pattern offers. I presented Panorama of the Netherlands in London last year, and they told me that there in London there are metro lines, if you go to East London, that by each metro stop, the life expectancy of the people living next to that metro stop is decreasing by 1 year. Whoa. Metro stop after metro stop, decreasing by 1 year. And that means that tells you what the quality of life, how poor the quality of life in these neighborhoods is. And that's also, if you look in Paris, in the banlieue, there are neighborhoods where you are really not safe, where it is such a horrible condition of how people are housed. That's all that we do not know in the Netherlands, thanks also to this old historical tissue of spread out cities. The key in the Netherlands will be how can we add a lot of houses. We have to build a million houses without building in between all these old city centers. So our advice to the government and also to the developers is try to add houses in the existing neighborhoods by transforming them and upgrading their qualities. And we're doing tests with that, and because then you can actually improve existing neighborhoods without consuming the countryside. And I think that's the balance we have to find there.
Really important questions. Yes, my co-worker will come over with a microphone, and I have to repeat the question for the live stream so that you just know. Yeah. Actually, that's really hard to repeat. Can you shorten it?
I think the question is clear. That what we witness in our cities and in specific neighborhoods is a process of segregation. Eh? And that can be segregation in age groups, but usually also income groups. Eh? Something especially you witness a lot in popular neighborhoods in cities. Eh? In Amsterdam, for instance, it's very manifest. Okay. That.
Gentrification.
Okay. Okay, that changes the question, but also the answer, of course. Now, the process of gentrification is part of city life, and it's something which usually you see in bad neighborhoods, poor neighborhoods, that people move in who have a lot of creativity but no money. That can be artists, that can be students, that can be young people building up a life, and then indeed a process of gentrification is becoming manifest. And I think that's something where local governments have to play an important role to make sure that the forces that generated all these improvements, making it a more interesting neighborhood, that they are not pushed out of that neighborhood once it's upgraded, that the people who have more money move in. In that sense, I think I mentioned already Amsterdam in the respect of segregation, but also in the gentrification. If you look at area west in Amsterdam, this is the new neighborhoods, the neighborhoods where the poor people live, but now the pressure on Amsterdam is so big that the richer people move in and the poor people are kicked out. And I think government should take responsibility for that, to make sure that the city is for everybody. And in that respect, I also mentioned here at Landbouwbelang, the building. You might not like it as a city. You might think it's ugly. You might think it's dirty. You might not like the people living there. But they're part of our society, and they generate a buzz. They generate a meaning. And that's what cities are about, the art of living together. And I think when you talk about gentrification as a motor to exclude people, that is, I think, where it goes wrong. And that's where we should act and take responsibility.
Yes.
Thank you very much for your lecture. I liked a lot that you went into the master specific sites. And I wonder what would be examples of maybe you have recommendations for the city to improve on water management regarding groundwater or something against the
build-up
of the city's heat in the summer months.
Yeah, no, it's indeed, like I mentioned, all disasters in the world are water-related, but a lot of urban questions are water-related too. I think when we talk about heat stress in our cities, the summers are getting so hot now that it's a real issue. And water can play an important role there, and of course, if you look at our countryside, it's only one question now is evacuating the water, where we now learn that we have to keep the water. Huh? And these are changes where the city, our farmers, our landscapes can start to collaborate. And that's a change of mindset where the cities can benefit a lot from. If you look at sustainable energy, we often think about the windmills or the solar panels, but there is a new technique, aquathermy, which is very, very promising. And it has to do with the fact that you can generate energy from the water on in your cities. And you take some heat from the water, which is for the life in the water very beneficial. And you can use it for energy in your houses. So all of a sudden, water can have a different meaning in the city. So it has a lot of things you can combine. You can also say rainwater falling on our roofs should not go in the sewer, but should go on, etc. So you, if you start to combine these things, then it can be a beautiful motor to address a lot of questions. So I think indeed cities should be aware of it, and as well as our dijkgraven, our waterschappen, the water boards should be more aware of these possibilities as they are beginning to. Yeah.
Actually, last week
I gave a lecture to the collected boards of water management in the Netherlands, the water boards, and I explained them, okay, but nowadays it's no longer about evacuating the water, but it's about keeping the water. I think half of them agreed, half of them did not agree. But they say, well, no, water safety is our mission. And what you're talking about is interesting, it's not our mission. The other half said, oh no, but don't listen to them. We do understand our mission is getting broader. So it's cultures are changing. And like I said, this is an interesting time to live in because people are getting aware. And all these changes, they're relevant, they mean something, and they make big improvements.
Thank hopefully. You.
Well, you said, because it will end at that same of love.
I never said nor intended that overpopulation is not a problem. I only said there are movements, there are changes happening that we do not control, or only partly control. And so far, the estimations were at the end of the century, 11, maybe 12 billion people. Now, out of more scientific research, more precise research, they say, well, we probably won't reach 10 billion people. And that makes a difference. I'm not saying that's not a problem. I'm saying things are changing there. And of course, 2064 is far away, 44 years, but it's one generation. And we also already, when we talk about cities, if we talk about urban planning, cities last much longer than 44 years. We have to start to rethink the way we work with growth versus shrinking cities. It means a lot. It is not something which is easy to take care of, as Maastricht maybe is also witnessing. If the population is decreasing, it raises new questions. And these questions have to do with power, they have to do with food production, they have to do with an older population. There's a lot of changes coming, so I'm definitely not saying it's not a problem, but I do say things are changing, and we have to look into what that means. And of course, the current population in the world is having a big claim on how we produce food, how we live with it. But things are evolving. At least it's on the agenda now. And like I said, I had this beautiful collection of world leaders. I don't think solutions are coming from there. But to address these questions, our nation is not too small, I think.
I think those are beautiful last words for this evening. Mm. Thank you very much, Floris Alkemade, for your insightful and also really beautiful lecture, I have to say. There were so many inspiring pictures in your presentation. I also would like to thank you, the audience in the room, the audience at home. This is a really new experience, but I'm still really happy that in my imagination, when I look at the room, it is actually full. I also would like to thank Bureau Europa, Floor and Remco for collaborating with us on this really special event. And for now, thank you very much. Have a great evening and see you next week.